Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome once again to our study in 1 Peter. If you got your Bibles at home and you want to follow along, turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 5, and we'll be in verses 5 through 7. The title of our lesson this morning is Humility. Let's read. It says this, "Likewise, you who are younger, be subject to the elders. Clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility toward one another, for God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you." Well, obviously from the title, today we're going to talk about humility. And Webster's Dictionary defines humility as a modest or low view of one's own importance. And another way to look at it, the other side of the coin, could be freedom from pride or arrogance, or the opposite of pride or arrogance. Now, it should probably go without saying this morning that humility is not a popular subject in the modern world. If you turn on talk shows, they're not going to talk about humility. If you listen to a valedictorian speech, they're probably not going to mention humility. If you go to a self-help seminar, they're not going to laud humility. In fact, I thought this morning I would actually give you an example of this. And we hear a lot today about core values. And core values can be are basically the fundamental beliefs of a person, or it can even be the fundamental beliefs of an organization. They're a set of guiding principles that is meant to keep a person or a company or a business on the right path within certain patterns of behavior, if you will. So we hear about this a lot. Companies have core values. And so I went to several websites to get examples of core values. You know, what if I wanted, you know, I was a new company and I wanted to write a list of core values. And so there's several websites out there that give you examples. So I just listed a few of these here. I won't read them all, but you have things like dependability, loyalty, open-mindedness, honesty, innovation, good humor, positivity, optimism, respect, courage, patriotism, environmentalism, and you just get these long lists. But I'm telling you, every single list I went to, there was something missing. And that is, not a single list of core values that I could find even came close to mentioning the characteristic of humility. Now, the reason for this turns out to be pretty simple. According to Scripture, humility can only survive in the presence of God. You can almost say, if you will, that humility follows God kind of like a shadow. And when you have a culture that acknowledges God, then humility is seen as a virtue. It's lauded as a characteristic. But in a culture that dismisses God, and like here in America today, humility will be completely ignored, which is, we've just seen in those list of core values. Now, why is this? Well, here's why. Because when God is neglected or God is dismissed, the runner-up God takes his place, and the runner-up God is always man. You see, by definition, that is the opposite of humility. That is pride. Psalms 10:4 says this, "In his pride, the wicked does not seek him. In all his thoughts, there is no room for God." You see, with pride, there's no room for God. But with God, there's no room for pride. These two things cannot coexist with one another. Now, why is pride so sinful? Well, pride is giving ourselves credit for something that God has accomplished. Pride is taking the glory for things where that glory should be for God and God alone. It is essentially self-worship. I mean, you think about it. Nothing we accomplish in this world, nothing, would be possible if it weren't for God. He created us. He gives us the breath that's in me right now. He gives us the talent to do the things that we do. Everything comes from him. 1 Corinthians 4:7 says this, "What do you have that you didn't receive? And if you didn't receive it, why do you boast as though you didn't? See, that is why we give God glory, because He alone is the one that deserves it. But you see, we live in a world that is absolutely hostile to humility. And the text we're studying today is foreign to our times. People just don't understand humility. They don't see why it would be a virtue. But yet a text like this today in Peter is utterly necessary. Because if what we're studying here today doesn't take root in our lives as individuals, then we're not a Christian church. We're not going to be salt and light for a lost and dying world. Now, to be honest, this is not a complicated scripture. The main point is very straightforward and very simple, and that is Christians should be a humble people. In verse 5a, it says this, "Younger men, be subject to your elders." In other words, be humble toward them. Bring yourself under them. Consider them more important than you. Verse 5b says, "All of you, clothe yourself with humility towards one another." And of course, verse 6 says, "Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God." So again, not complicated. The point is clear. Humility should be a defining mark or a defining characteristic or a defining virtue of a true Christian. Now, Peter is going to give us four incentives to be humble. Okay, the first one is this. God opposes the proud. Proverbs 8:13 says this, "The fear of the Lord is hatred of evil. Pride and arrogance and the way of evil and perverted speech I hate." God absolutely hates pride and arrogance. Now let me tell you, it's not good in this life to have someone that's in a powerful position be against you. But nothing could be worse than having a mighty, powerful, holy God be against you. So that's the first incentive. God opposes the proud. So Peter says, don't be proud. His second incentive is on the positive. He said, God gives grace to the humble. Now let's just think about that for a second. Not only, if you're humble, not only is God not opposed to you, He is now for you. And nothing could be better than that, right? Nothing can be better that this wise and holy and mighty and awesome, powerful God is not only against you, now He's for you. Now He's going to treat you graciously. That is what God does for the humble. Now, why does He do that? Because humility is a confession of emptiness. It's a confession to God that I can't do this. I don't have it in me to do this. I'm not that important. I don't measure up. It's a meekness of spirit. It is the absolute opposite of pride. That's why Jesus said in Matthew 5:3, "Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who recognize their utter spiritual bankruptcy." Let me say it again. Blessed are those who recognize their utter spiritual bankruptcy. And they recognize they have no ability. They have nothing to offer. They have nothing to merit anything from God. And so they come to God with inability, and God rewards that. The proud, on the other hand, completely different. They are sometimes so blinded by God, by their pride, they think they have no need of God. Or worse yet, they think God should accept them because they deserve His acceptance. Number three, Peter says God will exalt the humble at the proper time. You see, in the end, we don't have to exalt ourselves. We don't have to lift ourselves up. God is going to do that when the time is right. And that is a wonderful thing to look forward to. Number four, Peter says this, God cares for the humble. Now we're going to come back to that statement in detail in just a few minutes. But for now, just make sure we see this as an incentive that God cares for humble people. So very quickly, let's summarize what we've learned. God is against the proud, right? But if you are humble, He'll give you grace. He'll exalt you in due time. And in the meantime, before that exaltation comes, He'll take care of you. So you don't have to be worried and have anxiousness and have fear. Now, I want to take a minute here to talk a little bit about pride and humility and kind of superimpose these one against another. What are the real differences between them? Now, I want to try to answer that question by looking at a few biblical observations about pride. And of course, humility is the opposite of that. The first thing that we learn in the Bible is pride is self-satisfaction. Hosea 13, 5 through 6, God says, "I took care of you in the wilderness, in that dry and thirsty land. But when you had eaten and were satisfied, you became proud and forgot me." You see, many times when we are satisfied, we don't have any need. We lose that humility, that inability, because we're satisfied, we're full, we're taken care of. And the Bible says, be careful then, because that's when pride will creep in. The Bible also tells us that pride is self-reliance. Deuteronomy 8, 11 through 17, God says, "But that is the time to be careful. Beware that in your plenty you do not forget the Lord your God. For when you have become full and prosperous and you've built fine homes to live in, and when your flocks and your herds have become large and your silver and gold have multiplied along with everything else, be careful. Do not become proud at that time and forget the Lord your God. Don't forget that he led you through the great and terrifying wilderness. Don't forget that he gave you water from the rock. He did all this so you would never say to yourself, 'I have achieved this with my own strength and my own energy.'" Pride ignores instruction is another thing the Bible tells us. Jeremiah 13, 9 through 10. "Thus says the Lord, even so will I spoil the pride of Judah and the great pride of Jerusalem, this evil people who refuse to hear my words and stubbornly follow their own heart." Pride takes credit, as we mentioned earlier. We see this in the story of Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel chapter 4, where the King Nebuchadnezzar said, "Is not this great Babylon, which I have built by my mighty power, as a royal residence and for the glory of my majesty?" And while the words were still in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven, "O King Nebuchadnezzar, to you is spoken, the kingdom has departed from you, until you know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will." Pride likes the best seats. Matthew 23, Jesus said this of the Pharisees, "And they love places of honor at feast, and they love the best seats in the synagogue, and they love greetings in the marketplace, and they love being called rabbi by other people." And then he goes on to say, "But whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted." Pride opposes the existence of God. Now, we brought this up earlier, but I wanted to come back to this. I think it's a very important scripture. It says, "In his pride," Psalms 10:4, "the wicked does not seek him. In all his thoughts, there's no room for God." See, we said that earlier. When pride is in the house, there's no room for God. When God's in the house, there's no room for pride. You can think of pride like a virus. We're in the middle of this coronavirus, so we might as well think of it like that. In order to survive, it has to avoid the one thing that kills it. And the one thing that kills pride is God. So it should come as no surprise then that pride will, not only is there no room for God, pride refuses to trust God. Proverbs 28, 25, "He who is of a proud heart stirs up strife. But the opposite of pride is one who trusts in the Lord, and he will be prospered." You see, pride cannot trust God. See, pride by its nature doesn't want to look weak. Pride by its very nature doesn't want to look dependent on somebody else. But see, that's exactly what humility does. Humility says, "God, I can't do it. God, I need you. I need your everything about you. I have nothing in me." See, that's why trusting God is the literal heartbeat of humility. I have one more thing that pride is. You see, when pride keeps us from acknowledging God, and pride keeps us from trusting God, two things can happen. Normally, we'll start out with a false sense of security. We'll feel like, "Man, I'm in control. I'm the captain of my ship. I'm the master of my fate." And we feel like we can take care of everything ourselves until the day comes that we can't. And then there's always going to come a day when you finally realize you really have no control at all. Which brings us to the last trait of pride. Pride is anxious about the future. Pride worries. Pride fears. Isaiah 51:12, an incredible verse. Listen to this. This is the voice of God. God says, I am he who comforts you. Who are you that you're afraid? I mean, read that again. Literally, God says, who do you think you are that you would be afraid? See, that's how subtle pride is. Pride says, I can take care of myself. That's why pride is the root of worry, the root of anxiety, because pride says it's all on me. And you know that there's things out of your control. You know you can't see what's coming down the road tomorrow. So pride always, worry and anxiety and fear always follows along with pride. And see, right in the midst of this, Peter said this, cast your cares on him. Now, here's what I want you to see today. This is probably the most important thing to me. That's a verse we can all quote. I guarantee you pretty much anybody listening to this can say, cast your cares upon him because he cares for you. We all know that verse. But how many of us see it in context? How many of us see how it is intricately related to being humble? Let's go back and read verses 6 through 7 and see it for yourself. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so at the proper time he may exalt you, comma, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. This isn't two separate thoughts. This is one thought. Humble yourselves. How do I humble myself? By casting all my worries and all my cares and all my anxieties on him. You see, pride worries. Humility casts your cares on Jesus. Pride has anxiety and fear, but humility casts them all on Jesus. You see, casting your anxiety on God means trusting the promise that he cares for you. It means trusting that he has the power and the wisdom to put that care to work in the most glorious way. See, that type of trust is the 100% or 180 degrees opposite of pride. It's the confidence that the mighty hand of God is not there to crush you, but the mighty hand of God is there to care for you and to uphold you. I love those two images that are superimposed in this passage. You've got the Christian who's humble, he's peaceful, he's lowly, and then you've got this holy and powerful and mighty God whose hand he carries our worries. So whenever your heart starts to be anxious about the future, here's what you need to do. Preach to yourself. Say to yourself, Derek, who do you think you are to be afraid? Who do you think you are to be afraid? See, anxiety is a sign of pride. It's a sign of self-exaltation. It's a sign that you feel responsible for yourself. So preach to yourself. Remind you that you have a God in heaven who cares for you, a mighty God, a holy God, who has a mighty hand. Now, I want to close with this. That's all good stuff, right? But how do I practically cast my cares? How do I do that in practice, right? Let's jump back to the Gospel of Luke, and we'll get a little bit of a clue here. In Luke 19, we all know the story. The young colt is brought to Jesus, the young donkey. And it says this, and they brought it to Jesus, and throwing, and that's the exact same word in Greek, and casting their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. So the meaning, when Peter says, cast your cares, it's a very simple meaning. You see, if you have a garment, or you have a sack, or you have a heavy load, and you want an animal like a donkey to carry that for you, you cast that thing on the animal. You throw it on the animal. And you don't carry it anymore, right? The animal itself is carrying the burden. The load is on the animal, not on you. The donkey is working for you, right? It's this exact same thing. God is willing to carry your load. God is willing to carry your anxieties, to carry your worries, to carry your fears. Man, I just love this about the Bible. Before the Bible ever comes to us and says, hey, I want you to do these things, He always comes to us and says, I want to first do these things for you. I mean, that's just amazing to me. Matthew 11:28, Jesus says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Psalms 55:22, cast your burden on the Lord, and He will sustain you. Isaiah 46:4, even to your old age I am He, and to gray hairs I will carry you. I've made you, and I'll bear you. I'll carry you, and I will save. Isaiah 64:4, from of old no one is heard or perceived by the ear. No one has seen a God beside you who acts for those who wait for Him. See, the scriptures are clear. God wants to carry us. God wants to work for us. God wants to carry our burden, carry our load from the time we're small to the time that we lay down in that grave. So throw your garments of anxiety onto Him. Now, you may say, well, that's all great, but how do I practically do that? Let's go back and look at the passage. 1 Peter 5:7, casting all your anxieties on Him. Why, Peter? Because He cares for you. How do I practically cast my cares on Jesus? I believe what the Bible says. I believe it. I just believe what He promises He will do. Why does God want to carry my burdens? Because He loves me. Because He cares for me. So why don't I just trust that word? Why don't I just believe that promise? You know, it's a funny thing. It's funny how things always come back to this little thing called faith. This little thing called faith, which is just believing what God says He will do. Believing what God says He will do. You see, I think too often we trust God in the abstract. And what I mean by that is it's so easy to say, yes, God is trustworthy. Yes, God can save. Yes, God works all things for good to those that love Him. But you see, this text is very specific. He says, cast all your cares on Him because He cares for you. See, He's saying, lay your anxieties, your specific anxieties, not general anxieties, not the burdens of the world, but your worries, your cares, your fears, you put them on Him. Trust that He specifically cares about you for this specific thing and give it to Him. See, when it says He cares, it means He's not just going to stand by and just let things develop any old way. No, He's going to act. He's going to work. He's going to take over. Now listen, it's not always going to come out the way we thought it should. Right? See, God is God. He sees a thousand, a million connections that we never see. He knows the future. He knows all these things. That's part of the trust. That's part of the humility. I want to close with one final thing, and I would be bereft if I didn't hit this one thing, and that is this connection with prayer, how casting your cares on Him connects with prayer. Look at Philippians 4:6. Paul says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which passes all comprehension, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. See, the connection is really simple. I trust that God cares about my anxiety. That's faith. I believe. But then I turn around and I express that in prayer. That's works. You see, James said, faith without works is not faith, it's dead. See, when we really believe that God cares about my worries and cares and anxieties, the result of that is we take those worries and cares and anxieties and we take them to Him in prayer. Prayer is trust turned toward God and spoken with our mouth. There's an old song we all know. What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. You know, we live in a day and a time, let's be honest, where anxiousness and fear and worry are just rife across our America today, across our cities, across our homes. And yet, here we have this beautiful scripture, this wonderful scripture that's written for our encouragement in a day just like this. So cast your cares on Him. Believe that when He says, "I care for you," believe that. Then put that belief in action by taking everything to God in prayer. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, what a wonderful word here from Peter. And I thank you, God, I am just astounded. I'm always astounded how relevant your word is for me. How relevant your word is for our church. How relevant your word is for our times. But there's so much strife out there today, Lord. There's so much going on. And it's so easy to get caught up in anxiousness and fear. But help us see, God, that that's a sign of pride. We have no control of anything. We have no clue what's going to happen in the next minute, much less the next month or the next year. But you do. You are our God. You know all those things. So, Father, help us humble ourselves by taking those anxieties and cares and fears and casting them on you. God, help us to be a people of courage and boldness and peace, because all of those things are being carried by you. I ask that in Jesus' holy name. Amen.